Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is a guest of Pastor Brad Brandon on radio program Word of Truth to discuss same-sex marriage.
Let's go to our insider hotline where we have Dr. Jennifer Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Doctor, welcome to the Word of Truth radio program.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Hey, it's great to have you. I heard that you were at a debate earlier today. You participated in a debate at the U of M right here in Minneapolis.
Yes, that's right. It was a debate on the definition of marriage, the fate of the marriage amendment that's coming up. And it was I was the only outside person brought in from out of state. There was a state representative in favor of the marriage amendment, one opposed to it, and then a law professor who's well known as an advocate of gay rights and so on. So I was a person there, kind of a outside visiting expert, arguing in favor of the marriage amendment, why Minnesota needs it, why it's good policy, and why everybody should vote yes for the marriage amendment.
I was reading your 77 non-religious reasons to support man-woman marriage, and I think that that's phenomenal. But I got to ask you a question. Who was the state rep who was arguing with you?
Let me make sure I pronounce his name correctly. It was Glenn Grunhagen.
Grunhagen. Okay, got it.
You know who I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do.
He was one of the co-sponsors of the thing. He was one of the co-sponsors.
Absolutely. So. Now, that's phenomenal. I'm glad that you got an opportunity to meet. How did the debate go?
The debate. It was a lot of back and forth, and it was a very highly structured debate. You know, I think over at the U of M, they know that all of their students and faculty basically are in favor of redefining marriage to include same-sex couples and to remove the gender requirement out of marriage. You know, everybody there is in favor of it, so much so that, you know, somebody like me will come in and, you know, they're afraid it'll get nasty or something, you know. So anyway, they had it very, very carefully orchestrated, very carefully scripted and so on. And so it was very civil. And I think a lot of good information came out on both sides. I doubt very seriously if I changed the minds of many of those people, but I think I certainly gave them something to think about that they hadn't thought about before, that's for sure.
Well, I think you certainly planted a seed. And no doubt the U of M does a good job at brainwashing their faculty and students.
You know, I have to tell you that, you know, they told me they got the one and only registered Republican on the faculty to be the moderator of this event. You know, I mean, not that being a Republican is a pure guide to anything necessarily, you know, but still, it was kind of interesting.
I'm going to throw your website up.
But I'll tell you something. I think your listeners will be interested to know. My organization is called the Ruth Institute, and the mission of the Ruth Institute is to promote lifelong married love to college students and other young adults. And the reason I was at the U of M campus, the reason I was brought in, is because of students. You know, I just want you to know that there are young people who believe in socially conservative values. There are well brought up evangelical Christians and Catholics who know what their faith teaches them and who are trying to live out their faith. And those are the kids who brought me in there. And I'm very proud of those kids because there's only like a handful of them, you know.
Oh, you mean students brought you in?
Do what?
The students brought you in.
In other words, it was student organizations that brought me in, you see. So there's the Federalist Society, which is the student, the conservative student law group, and they sponsored the debate. And at the same time, there's a Christian Legal Society at the law school, and there's something called the Thomas More Law Society, which is a Catholic legal scholarship kind of thing. And so those are the young people who made it possible for me to come. So I think that's just phenomenal.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, you guys should, you know, everybody in the Christian community should know that there are good young people, and, you know, in spite of all the craziness that you hear about universities, there are good young people who have good, solid values and who deserve your support.
Wow, I am very energized to hear that. Go to ruthinstitute.org. There's lots of great information on there. I was on there earlier reading it. And that's great news to hear about that. Doctor, do you think that we're losing the war on the, and I don't want to say war, but do you think we're losing the argument to the younger generation? It just seems like the younger generation already has their mind made up and they already are not socially conservative at all and have no interest in being.
Well, It's a funny thing that you say that, because if you were just looking at the issue of the definition of marriage and whether it should be between a man and a woman or whether it should be between any two persons, you would be correct to say what you said. Mm-hmm. You know, that young people, and the reason young people are like that is because in their minds, marriage is just about how adults feel about each other, you know, first of all. And second of all, in their minds, male and female doesn't matter very much. You know, those are both things they've been taught, you know, that gender is kind of just made up, you know, and
yes.
It's all socially constructed. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't mean anything. So they believe that, and they also believe that marriage doesn't really have anything to do with kids, doesn't really have anything to do with protecting children's rights to know and be loved by their parents, that marriage is really just about adults and how adults. Those two things, Brad. If you believe those two things, why shouldn't we
That's
have
right.
same-sex marriage?
Yes.
You know, so in that sense, the younger generation, you know, we are losing them. We got to work on that. But you said social conservative, so I got to point out to you that the younger generation is much more pro-life than their elders. Okay, the pro-life movement. If you ever go hang around the pro-life movement, it's a youth movement. You know, it's packed with young people.
Mm-hmm.
And so you ask yourself, well, now what is that about? Well, I think because, you know, I don't know how old you are, and I won't ask, but in 1973...
I'm very young.
I'm young at heart, as you can tell.
In
1973, when Roe versus Wade came down, what did people say at that time? They said, oh, you know, the young people are all going to believe in abortion.
Mm-hmm.
All your objections to abortion, that's all going to go away because the young people are going to, you know, they won't have known anything else, and it's going to be just like pulling a tooth to them. They're not going to care about scraping a little bit of tissue out of the uterus. You know, you old dinosaurs, you're all going to die off, and, you know, there's not going to be any opposition to abortion in 30 years' time. You know, well, what happened over time, in fact, is that over time, it becomes more and more clear that the abortion regime is brutal. And it's brutal precisely in the way that it sets aside the interests of children to support the interests of adults, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's not obvious immediately, right? But now it's totally obvious, you know?
Yes.
And I think a lot of young people see it and they don't like it. And I think that that something similar can be done to help them see the point of marriage. But I think we need to get on with it. You know, I think everybody needs to, you know, man their station, so to speak, and, you know, get up off the couch and do their part to promote marriage, because young people really, you know, they have such a faulty understanding of the basics, right, that they are vulnerable to, you know, kind of being seduced by this whole being swept away in the tide of advocating genderless marriage, you know. But I think they can be brought around. I really do.
And I think you make a great point, because oftentimes at the very early inception of a particular ideology or agenda, if you will, it's hard to see it in its full fruition. It's hard to see it when it's all the way done. And I think we're at the end of that with abortion. I mean, we've got people now calling up two professors out of Australia that are calling for afterbirth abortions. So now it's very easy to look around and say, oh, this is the full fruition when we allow abortions. And I think that you're right. The youth culture looks at that and says, well, this is crazy. We're not about this. Do you think
that
the same thing will happen with marriage if we just give it some time?
Well, no, absolutely not. We can't just give it some time. we have to be out on the stump talking about it and pointing to the problems as they're happening, because there are already, you know, cracks in the armor, so to speak, of this sort of great juggernaut of same-sex marriage coming at a show. There are already cases that illustrate just how crazy this is going to get when you have multiple parents. When you have same-sex parents, you can't just have two parents. You got to have at least three, right?
That's right.
Because the couple can't pull it off on their own. They got to have participation from someone else. And so some of those cases where there's a dispute between a lesbian couple, those cases are coming into court, and they're not pretty, you know. There was a recent case out of the UK where there were two women who were lesbians and two men who were gay, and they had teamed up to try to have kids together, and The lesbians thought, the women thought that the kids were going to be their kids and men were just going to kind of hang around once in a while. And the men didn't think that at all, you know. And so the kids are like, I think their kids are like 8 years old and 5 years old. And of course the people are in court slugging it out, trying to figure out what they're going to do. And when I read this case, I mean, you would be amazed. The judge, the poor judge, I mean, think about this. Just some poor schmuck family law judge sitting there trying to figure out what is he going to do with these kids, you know. The children are attached to the men and care about them, and the adults are all arguing among themselves and so on. And the judge, you know, he kind of threw up his hands and said, well, I guess the kids have to stay with the women. But you know, you guys, you really should have thought this through before you did
this. You think?
You know, you really should have thought this through. And I think that when the judges get these incredibly complex cases, it becomes clear that there isn't any just way to resolve it. See, there's no resolution to a situation like that that gives the adults what they want. And it gives the children what they're entitled to, namely a relationship with their biological parents.
Right.
And some connection to the people that have spent a lot of time with them, you know. I mean,
yes.
Incredibly complex. And so it isn't really possible to do justice in that situation.
I wish we had more time. We're going to have to get you back on the program. This is great information. But, you know, you just speak to the enlarging the size of government also the issue with this as well. But we'll have to continue this some other time. Thank you for coming on the program, Dr. Jennifer Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Thanks for spending some time with us today.
Thanks for having me on.
Dr. Jennifer Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. You can go to ruthinstitute.org for more information. She's got a great brochure on there called 77 Non-Religious Reasons to Support Man-Woman Marriage. And it's a phenomenal, phenomenal brochure with a lot of great information.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Pastor Brad Branton discussing same-sex marriage on Word of Truth. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.